wanderers from the beginning. We knew every stand of tree for 100 miles. When the fruits or nuts were ripe, we were there. We followed the herds in their annual migrations. We rejoiced in fresh meat. Through stealth, feint, ambush, and main force assault, a few of us cooperating accomplished what many of us, each hunting alone, could not. We depended on one another. Making it on our own was as ludicrous to imagine as was settling down. Working together, we protected our children from the lions and the hyenas. We taught them the skills they would need and the tools. Then, as now, technology was the key to our survival. When the drought was prolonged, or when an unsettling chill lingered in the summer air, our group moved on, sometimes to unknown lands. We sought a better place. And when we couldn't get on with the others in our little nomadic band, we left to find a more friendly bunch somewhere else. We could always begin again. For 99.9% of the time since our species came to be, we were hunters and foragers, wanderers on the savannas and the steppes. There were no border guards then, no customs officials. The frontier was everywhere. We were bounded only by the earth and the ocean and the sky, plus occasional grumpy neighbors. When the climate was congenial, though, when the food was plentiful, we were willing to stay put, unadventurous, overweight, careless. In the last 10,000 years, an instant in our long history, we've abandoned the nomadic life. We've domesticated the plants and animals. Why chase the food when you can make it come to you? For all its material advantages, the sedentary life has left us edgy, unfulfilled. Even after 400 generations in villages and cities, we haven't forgotten. The open road still softly calls, like a nearly forgotten song of childhood. We invest far-off places with a certain romance. The appeal, I suspect, has been meticulously crafted by natural selection as an essential element in our survival. Long summers, mild winters, rich harvests, plentiful game. None of them lasts forever. It is beyond our powers to predict the future. Catastrophic events have a way of sneaking up on us, of catching us unaware. Your own life, or your band's, or even your species might be owed to a restless few drawn by a craving they can hardly articulate or understand to undiscovered lands and new worlds. Herman Melville in Moby Dick spoke for wanderers in all epochs and meridians. He said, "I am tormented with an everlasting itch for things remote. I love to sail forbidden seas." To the ancient Greeks and Romans, the known world comprised Europe and an attenuated Asia and Africa, all surrounded by an impassable world ocean. Travelers might encounter inferior beings called barbarians, or superior beings called gods. Every tree had its dryad, every district its legendary hero. But there were not very many gods, at least at first, perhaps only a few dozen. They lived on mountains, under the earth, in the sea, or up there in the sky. They sent messages to people, intervened in human affairs, and interbred with us. As time passed, as the human exploratory capacity hit its stride, there were surprises. Barbarians could be fully as clever as Greeks and Romans. Africa and Asia were larger than anyone had guessed. The world ocean was not impassable. There were Antipodes. Three new continents existed, had been settled by Asians in ages past, and the news had never reached Europe. Also, the gods were disappointingly hard to find. The first large-scale human migration from the Old World to the New happened during the last ice age, about 11,500 years ago, when the growing polar ice caps shallowed the oceans and made it possible to walk on dry land from Siberia to Alaska. 1,000 years later, we were in Tierra del Fuego, the southern tip of South America. Long before Columbus, Indonesian Argonauts in outrigger canoes explored the western Pacific. People from Borneo settled Madagascar. Egyptians and Libyans circumnavigated Africa. And a great fleet of ocean-going junks from Ming Dynasty China crisscrossed the Indian Ocean, established a base in Zanzibar, rounded the Cape of Good Hope, and entered the Atlantic Ocean. In the 15th through 17th centuries, European sailing ships discovered new continents, new at any rate to Europeans, and circumnavigated the planet. In the 18th and 19th centuries, American and Russian explorers, traders, and settlers raced west and east across two vast continents to the Pacific. This zest to explore and exploit, however thoughtless its agents may have been, has clear survival value. It is not restricted to any one nation or ethnic group. It is an endowment that all members of the human species hold in common. Since we first emerged a few million years ago in East Africa, we've meandered our way around the planet. There are now people on every continent and the remotest islands, from pole to pole, from Mount Everest to the Dead Sea, on the ocean bottoms, and even in residence 200 miles up. Humans, like the gods of old, living in the sky. These days, there seems to be nowhere left to explore, at least on the land area of the Earth. Victims of their very success, the explorers now pretty much stay home. Late in the 19th century, Leib Gruber was growing up in Central Europe, in an obscure town in the immense, polyglot, ancient Austro-Hungarian Empire. His father sold fish when he could, but times were often hard. As a young man, the only honest employment Leib could find was carrying people across the nearby river Bug. The customer, male or female, would mount on Leib's back. In his prized boots, the tools of his trade, he would wade out in a shallow stretch of the river and deliver his passenger to the opposite bank. Sometimes the water reached his waist. There were no bridges here, no ferry boats. Horses might have served the purpose, but they had other uses. That left Leib and a few other young men like him. They had no other uses. No other work was available. They would lounge about the riverbank, calling out their prices, boasting to potential customers about the superiority of their drayage. They hired themselves out like four-footed animals. My grandfather was a beast of burden. I don't think that in all his young manhood, Leib had ventured more than 100 kilometers from his little hometown of Sassof. But then, in 1904, he suddenly ran away to the New World to avoid a murder rap, according to one family legend. He left his young wife behind. How different from his tiny backwater hamlet the great German port cities must have seemed. How vast the ocean. How strange the lofty skyscrapers and endless hubbub of his new land. We know nothing of his crossing, but have found the ship's manifest for the journey undertaken later by his wife Chaya, joining Leib after he had saved enough to bring her over. She traveled in the cheapest class on the Batavia, a vessel of Hamburg registry. There's something heartbreakingly terse about the document. Can she read or write? No. Can she speak English? No. How much money does she have? I can imagine her vulnerability and her shame as she replies, $1. She disembarked in New York, was reunited with Leib, lived just long enough to give birth to my mother and her sister, and then died from complications of childbirth. In those few years in America, her name had sometimes been anglicized to Clara. A quarter century later, my mother named her own firstborn, a son, after the mother she never knew. Our distant ancestors, watching the stars, noted five that did more than just rise and set in stolid procession as the so-called fixed stars did. These five had a curious and complex motion. Over the months, they seemed to wander slowly among the stars. Sometimes they did loops. Today, we call them planets, the Greek word for wanderers. It was, I imagine, a peculiarity our ancestors could relate to. We know now that the planets are not stars, but other worlds, gravitationally lashed to the sun. Just as the exploration of the Earth was being completed, we began to recognize it as one world among an uncounted multitude of others, circling the sun or orbiting the other stars that make up the Milky Way galaxy. Our planet and our solar system are surrounded by a new world ocean, the depths of space. It is no more impassable than the last. Maybe it's a little early. Maybe the time is not quite yet. But those other worlds, promising untold opportunities, beckon. In the last few decades, the United States and the former Soviet Union have accomplished something stunning and historic. The close-up examination of all those points of light, from Mercury to Saturn, that moved our ancestors to wonder and to science. Since the advent of successful interplanetary flight in 1962, our machines have flown by, or orbited, or landed on more than 70 new worlds. We have wandered among the wanderers. We have found vast volcanic eminences that dwarf the highest mountain on Earth. Ancient river valleys on two planets, enigmatically one too cold and the other too hot for running water. A giant planet with an interior of liquid metallic hydrogen into which 1,000 Earths would fit. Whole moons that have melted. A cloud-covered place with an atmosphere of corrosive acids, where even the high plateaus are above the melting point of lead. Ancient surfaces on which a faithful record of the violent formation of the solar system is engraved. Refugee ice worlds from the trans-Plutonian depths. Exquisitely patterned ring systems marking the subtle harmonies of gravity. And a world surrounded by clouds of complex organic molecules like those that in the earliest history of our planet led to the origin of life. Silently, they orbit the sun, waiting. We have uncovered wonders undreamt by our ancestors who first speculated on the nature of those wandering lights in the night sky. We have proved the origins of our planet and ourselves. By discovering what else is possible, by coming face to face with alternative fates of worlds more or less like our own, we have begun to better understand the Earth. Every one of those worlds is lovely and instructive. But so far as we know, they are also, every one of them, desolate and barren. Out there, there are no better places. So far, at least. during the Viking robotic missions, beginning in July 1976. In a certain sense, I spent a year on Mars. I examined the boulders and sand dunes, the sky red even at high noon, the ancient river valleys, the soaring volcanic mountains, the fierce wind erosion, the laminated polar terrain, the two dark potato-shaped moons. But there was no life. Not a cricket or a blade of grass, or even, so far as we can tell for sure, a microbe. Life is a comparative rarity. You can survey dozens of worlds and find that in only one of them does life arise and evolve and persist. Having in all their lives till then crossed nothing wider than a river, Leib and Chaya graduated to crossing oceans. They had one great advantage. On the other side of the waters there would be, invested with outlandish customs, it's true, other human beings, speaking their language and sharing at least some of their values, even people to whom they were closely related. In our time, we've crossed the solar system and sent four ships to the stars. Neptune lies a million times further from Earth than New York City is from the banks of the River Bug. But there are no distant relatives, no humans, and apparently no life waiting for us on those other worlds. No letters conveyed by recent emigres help us to understand the new land. Only digital data transmitted at the speed of light by unfeeling, precise robot emissaries. They tell us that these new worlds are not much like home, but we continue to search for inhabitants. We can't help it. Life looks for life. No one on Earth, not the richest among us, can afford the passage. So we can't pick up and leave for Mars or Titan on a whim, or because we're bored or out of work or drafted into the army or oppressed, or because justly or unjustly we've been accused of a crime. There does not seem to be sufficient short-term profit to motivate private industry. If we humans ever go to those worlds, then it will be because a nation or a consortium of them believes it to be to its advantage, or to the advantage of the human species. Just now, there are a great many matters that are pressing in on us, that compete for the money it takes to send people to other worlds. Should we solve those problems first? Or are they a reason for going?
Mythmakers knew we're children equally of the earth and the sky. In our tenure on this planet, we've accumulated dangerous evolutionary baggage, propensities for aggression and ritual, submission to leaders, hostility to outsiders, all of which puts our survival in some doubt. But we've also acquired compassion for others, love for our children, a desire to learn from history and experience, and a great soaring passionate intelligence, the clear tools for our continued survival and prosperity. Which aspects of our nature will prevail is uncertain, particularly when our visions and prospects are bound to one small part of the small planet Earth. But up there in the cosmos, an inescapable perspective awaits. National boundaries are not evident when we view the Earth from space. Fanatic ethnic or religious or national identifications are a little difficult to support when we see our planet as a fragile blue crescent fading to become an inconspicuous point of light against the bastion and citadel of the stars.
The spacecraft was a long way from home, speeding away from the sun at 40,000 miles an hour. But in early February of 1990, it was overtaken by an urgent message from Earth. Obediently, it turned its cameras back toward the now distant planets, slewing its scan platform from one spot in the sky to another. It snapped 60 pictures and stored them in digital form on its tape recorder. Then slowly, in March, April, and May, it radioed the data back to Earth. Each image was composed of 640,000 pixels. The spacecraft was 3.7 billion miles away from Earth, so far away that it took each pixel 5.5 hours, traveling at the speed of light, to reach us. The pictures might have been returned earlier, but the big radio telescopes in California, Spain, and Australia that receive these whispers from the edge of the solar system had responsibilities to other ships that ply the sea of space, among them Magellan, bound for Venus, and Galileo on its tortuous passage to Jupiter. Voyager 1 was so high above the ecliptic plane because, in 1981, it had made a close pass by Titan, the giant moon of Saturn. Its sister ship, Voyager 2, was dispatched on a different trajectory, within the ecliptic plane, and so she was able to perform her celebrated explorations of Uranus and Neptune. The two Voyager robots have explored four planets and nearly 60 moons. They are triumphs of human engineering and one of the glories of the American space program. They will be in the history books when much else about our time is forgotten. The Voyagers were guaranteed to work only until the Saturn encounter. I thought it might be a good idea, just after Saturn, to have them take one last glance homeward. From Saturn, I knew, the Earth would appear too small for Voyager to make out any detail. Our planet would be just a point of light, a lonely pixel, hardly distinguishable from the many other points of light Voyager would see, nearby planets, far-off suns. Mariners had painstakingly mapped the coastlines of continents. Geographers had translated these findings into charts and globes. Photographs of tiny patches of the Earth had been obtained first by balloons and aircraft, then by rockets in brief ballistic flight, and at last by orbiting spacecraft, giving a perspective like the one you achieve by positioning your eyeball about an inch above a large globe. While almost everyone is taught that the Earth is a sphere, with all of us somehow glued to it by gravity, the reality of our circumstance did not really begin to sink in until the famous frame-filling Apollo photograph of the whole Earth, the one taken by the Apollo 17 astronauts on the last journey of humans to the moon. It has become a kind of icon of our age. There's Antarctica at what Americans and Europeans so readily regard as the bottom. And then all of Africa stretching up above it. You can see Ethiopia, Tanzania, and Kenya, where the earliest humans lived. At top right are Saudi Arabia and what Europeans call the Near East. Just barely peeking out at the top is the Mediterranean Sea, around which so much of our global civilization emerged. You can make out the blue of the ocean, the yellow-red of the Sahara and the Arabian Desert, the brown-green of forest and grassland. And yet, there is no sign of humans in this picture. Not our reworking of the Earth's surface, not our machines, not ourselves. We are too small, and our statecraft is too feeble to be seen by a spacecraft between the Earth and the Moon. From this vantage point, our obsession with nationalism is nowhere in evidence. The Apollo pictures of the whole Earth conveyed to multitudes something well known to astronomers. On the scale of worlds, to say nothing of stars or galaxies, humans are inconsequential, a thin film of life on an obscure and solitary lump of rock and metal. It seemed to me that another picture of the Earth, this one taken from 100,000 times farther away, might help in the continuing process of revealing to ourselves our true circumstance and condition. It had been well understood by the scientists and philosophers of classical antiquity that the Earth was a mere point in a vast, encompassing cosmos. But no one had ever seen it as such. Here was our first chance, and perhaps also our last, for decades to come. Many in NASA's Voyager project were supportive, but from the outer solar system, the Earth lies very near the Sun, like a moth enthralled around a flame. Did we want to aim the camera so close to the Sun as to risk burning out the spacecraft's Vidicon system? Wouldn't it be better to delay until all the scientific images from Uranus and Neptune, if the spacecraft lasted that long, were taken? And so we waited, and a good thing too. From 1981 at Saturn, to 1986 at Uranus, to 1989, when both spacecraft had passed the orbits of Neptune and Pluto. At last, the time came. But there were a few instrumental calibrations that needed to be done first, and we waited a little longer. Although the spacecraft were in the right spots, the instruments were still working beautifully, and there were no other pictures to take, a few project personnel opposed it. It wasn't science, they said. Then we discovered that the technicians who devise and transmit the radio commands to Voyager were in a cash-strapped NASA, to be laid off immediately or transferred to other jobs. If the picture were to be taken, it had to be done right then, at the last minute, actually in the midst of the Voyager 2 encounter with Neptune. The then NASA administrator, Rear Admiral Richard Truly, stepped in and made sure that these images were obtained. The space scientists Candy Hansen of NASA's Jet Propulsion Laboratory and Carolyn Porco of the University of Arizona designed the command sequence and calculated the camera exposure times. So here they are, a mosaic of squares laid down on top of the planets and a background smattering of more distant stars. We were able to photograph not only the Earth, but also five other of the Sun's nine known planets. Mercury, the innermost, was lost in the glare of the Sun, and Mars and Pluto were too small, too dimly lit, and or too far away. Uranus and Neptune are so dim that to record their presence required long exposures, and accordingly their images were smeared because of spacecraft motion. This is how the planets would look to an alien spaceship approaching the solar system after a long interstellar voyage. From this distance, the planets seem only points of light, smeared or unsmeared, even through the high-resolution telescope aboard Voyager. They are like the planets seen with the naked eye from the surface of the Earth, luminous dots, brighter than most of the stars. Over a period of months, the Earth, like the other planets, would seem to move among the stars. You cannot tell merely by looking at one of these dots what it's like, what's on it, what its past has been, and whether, in this particular epoch, anyone lives there. Because of the reflection of sunlight off the spacecraft, the Earth seems to be sitting in a beam of light, as if there were some special significance to this small world. But it's just an accident of geometry and optics. The Sun emits its radiation equitably in all directions. Had the picture been taken a little earlier or a little later, there would have been no sunbeam highlighting the Earth. And why that cerulean color? The blue comes partly from the sea, partly from the sky. While water in a glass is transparent, it absorbs slightly more red light than blue. If you have tens of meters of the stuff or more, the red light is absorbed out, and what gets reflected back to space is mainly blue. In the same way, a short line of sight through air seems perfectly transparent. Nevertheless, something Leonardo da Vinci excelled in portraying, the more distant the object, the bluer it seems. Why? Because the air scatters blue light around much better than it does red. So the bluish cast of this dot comes from its thick but transparent atmosphere and its deep oceans of liquid water. And the white? The Earth, on an average day, is about half covered with white water clouds. We can explain the wan blueness of this little world because we know it well. Whether an alien scientist newly arrived at the outskirts of our solar system could reliably deduce oceans and clouds in a thickish atmosphere is less certain. Neptune, for instance, is blue, but chiefly for different reasons. From this distant vantage point, the Earth might not seem of any particular interest. But for us, it's different. Consider again that dot. That's here. That's home. That's us. On it, everyone you love, everyone you know, everyone you ever heard of, every human being who ever was, lived out their lives. The aggregate of our joy and suffering, thousands of confident religions, ideologies, and economic doctrines, every hunter and forager, every hero and coward, every creator and destroyer of civilization, every king and peasant, every young couple in love, every mother and father, hopeful child, inventor and explorer, every teacher of morals, every corrupt politician, every superstar, every supreme leader, every saint and sinner in the history of our species lived there, on a mote of dust, suspended in a sunbeam. The Earth is a very small stage in a vast cosmic arena. Think of the rivers of blood spilled by all those generals and emperors so that in glory and triumph they could become the momentary masters of a fraction of a dot. Think of the endless cruelties visited by the inhabitants of one corner of this pixel on the scarcely distinguishable inhabitants of some other corner. How frequent their misunderstandings, how eager they are to kill one another, how fervent their hatreds. Our posturings, our imagined self-importance, the delusion that we have some privileged position in the universe, are challenged by this point of pale light. Our planet is a lonely speck in the great enveloping cosmic dark. In our obscurity, in all this vastness, there is no hint that help will come from elsewhere to save us from ourselves. The Earth is the only world known so far to harbor life. There is nowhere else, at least in the near future, to which our species could migrate. Visit? Yes. Settle? Not yet. Like it or not, for the moment, the Earth is where we make our stand.